Welcome to this first talk in a new quarterly series that the Shorewood Public Library is graciously hosting this year. We titled it at first with a title that now I think is a little off-putting, Women You Should Have Read, because it sort of puts the onus on you. And I started thinking about it. It's really just women we should read. And we picked philosophers for this year. We may do subsequent years. This one we're looking at Elisabeth of Bohemia, who was a woman philosopher, corresponded with Rene Descartes, probably one of the most famous philosophers in European philosophy. Really went toe-to-toe with him. She was a major intellect. She was also a princess, and she didn't do princessly things of the sort that we think of. Much of her time was spent occupied with dealing with not even state functions, but dealing with all the other people that got involved, surrounding courts and things like that. But really, what she wanted to do was to study philosophy and other important subjects. So she didn't get to do an awful lot of writing, unfortunately. But what we have of her is really quite good. What we're going to do in the subsequent sessions is talk about Eloise, if you've heard of Peter Abelard and Eloise and their great romance. That's the next one. And then Mary Wollstonecraft, something I'm particularly interested in and do writing on, will be the person for that. And then we'll talk about Margaret Cavendish. But those are coming months ahead. With Elizabeth and Eloise, we don't actually have that much writing by them. What we do have is in the form of letters. With the other authors who are later, we have much more that we can go on. So what I'm going to do in this talk is first give some broad overview and a few sort of initial comments. And then I want to lead you through Elizabeth's life up to her involvement with Rene Descartes. Including her backstory, which is really quite amazing. She's somebody who's at the center of much of what's happening in Europe at her time. So she's an important historical figure as well as intellectual figure. And then I want to discuss this correspondence with Descartes, which is the main writing that we have, and her involvement with him until he unfortunately dies fairly young of pneumonia. And there's a whole story why that's the case, that she had some role in. And then go through her later life a bit, and at the end suggest, give a few suggestions about how she might be profitably read if you're inclined to read her. And we should probably have some time for Q&A at the end, but I always encourage, if you want to ask questions at any time, I'm happy to answer them. Digressions are perfectly fine. I'm sort of like an old horse that knows the trail and can get back onto it no matter how far afield we range. So all that said, some overview. She is, like I said, genuinely a princess. She is from two noble families who are playing major roles in European politics at the time. She and her family wind up on the downside of things. So she's not a princess with lots of resources. She's a princess who gets kind of batted around along with the rest of her family. This is going to leave her, in certain respects, really, really well-equipped. She has an excellent education. She turns out to be somebody who can make the most of the education that she gets. She also doesn't have that many resources and winds up having a lot of her time consumed with non-intellectual pursuits, political pursuits. What we do have, what she did get to write, are her letters, and mainly here the correspondence with Rene Descartes. I want to tell you a little bit about the story of those. She did not want those letters to be published. They were, that's why we have them. But some of the people who write on her talk about it as if we're kept prying into her almost like her diary or something like that. It's not a diary, but it's correspondence with somebody else. Descartes was not supposed to publish these. He did, in fact, publish his side of the letters, and he passed on copies of her letters to this guy, Pierre Chanu, who was a French ambassador in Sweden. Chanu then passes them on to this guy, Claude Clercelier, who is a big fan of Descartes and wants to publish all of Descartes' stuff. Clercelier talks to Elizabeth and says, can I publish these? And she says, no, you can't publish them. So Clercelier is one of the few people who says, okay, I'm going to follow your choice. And interestingly, it's about 200 years where nobody gets to read them. And if it hadn't been for a few flukes, we wouldn't be reading them now, and we wouldn't know much about Elizabeth and Descartes. Her side of the correspondence gets published by a guy who is alerted to their existence by an antiquarian bookseller. He finds a packet of letters, and they're able to recognize, oh, these are these things that we've heard about. They get published, and now, you know, if you look at the sort of the standard French publication of Descartes' correspondence, they're in there. So that's kind of, yeah.
Which was the year then of the publication?
Oh, when they were finally published? Well, that's a good question. So it's sometime in the late 18th century. I'm not sure what the year of the collected works of Descartes edited by Adam and Tannery are, but that's later on. That's I think in the early 20th century perhaps. But that's working off of the older stuff. You know, they're gathering all these things together. But you know, when were these letters written? These are written in the 1640s.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, I mean, you know, there's actually, this is a bit of a digression, but when it comes to the history of philosophy, there's a lot of stuff that we're missing that we just don't have our hands on. Most of ancient literature is gone, you know. Of Epicurus, who was one of the most prolific authors in antiquity, we have three letters and two compilations of principal doctrines. One of which was discovered in the Vatican. It's called the Vatican Sayings. And we're kind of lucky we have those, unfortunately. We kind of wish that people were more careful with books back in the day, don't we? So now, going back to this, so Elizabeth is also a correspondent with other people. And I wanted to mention some of the other thinkers who she's connected with. One is somebody who is in the Cartesian path, Gottfried Leibniz, sometimes talked about as the universal genius of Europe. He was a very bright guy. He actually meets her towards the end of her life. He will also be connected with her house because her sister is going to be a patron of Leibniz, her younger sister, when her younger sister is in Hanover. And there's a whole long, interesting story there that we could go into if people want to later on. Through Leibniz, she's introduced to but never meets Nikolai Malebranche, and he's another important Cartesian philosopher. So she's got quite a few correspondents on that end. She also corresponds with some Quakers, with Robert Barclay and William Penn. They go to visit her when she is the abbess of a Protestant convent, and they continue a correspondence with her. They actually thought they might be able to convert her to become a Quaker, but she didn't do that. Another person who she corresponds with earlier than Descartes is this Anna Maria von Schnurmann, who is another woman philosopher working in the Netherlands. She is a protege of somebody who's a rival of Descartes. And she's an Aristotelian, and we'll talk a little bit about the rivalry that took place between those two groups. And then the other one who she corresponds with is somebody who is a bit more obscure, Johannes Kokeus. He's a theologian, Reformed theologian, who's got developing a sort of what we call covenant theology. And she sort of thought that he was doing something similar in theology and scriptural studies to what Descartes was doing in philosophy. And so we'll talk a bit more about what that meant exactly, you know, what Descartes' project was and why that would matter. But she was, you know, she liked this guy's work, and so she wrote back and forth to him, and she credits him for having directed her attention to scriptural study in a different way. Now, her life up to her correspondence with Descartes, I've given you two handouts that are useful for that. One of them is a map and been very helpfully marked with some of the places that are particularly important, in part because it's a little hard to see some of what's going on there. But that's a map of Central Europe. And you notice that there's a lot of differences from what it looks like now. I mean, France is still more or less where it is. But you've got Poland as this huge place. The Habsburgs, they control much of what's in the southern part of this map. You see all these little German principalities. They're all part of what's at that time called the Holy Roman Empire. At that time, Sweden and Denmark are major powers, major players on the scene. And if we date back a little bit, you know, Elizabeth is born in 1618 in Heidelberg, in what's the Palatinate. And you see that marked there on the map. Palatinate is one of those unfortunate territories where it's not really... Would you like this?
Yes, please.
Here, I'll pass this around.
Oh, thank you.
It's two separate places that are part of the same political unit. That always makes it difficult to defend, to take care of commerce and stuff like that. But her father is the elector of the Palatinate, and I'll tell you about elector in a minute why that matters. But you notice this: she's born about 100 years after the Protestant Reformation begins, and when the Protestant Reformation begins, you know, it takes a little while for them to sort things out, but fairly quickly they start realizing that they're not going to be able to come to terms. And not only is it, you know, Martin Luther standing up against, you know, the Pope about indulgences, that's just the start of things. That leads to this, you know, one thing after another. Martin Luther, you know, gets things started with Lutherans, but he's not the only important person. Philip Melanchthon plays a major role in Lutheranism. And then other people start saying, well, you know, if we're not just going to read things the way the Catholic Church wants us to read it, why do we have to read it the way Luther does? And you get you know, wars happening because of that. The peasants revolt. The peasants are influenced by some more radical theology. And all these different spin-off groups start coming out. The strongest of whom would be what we nowadays call the Reformed tradition, associated with John Calvin and Zwingli and people like that. But you have also a lot of other groups as well. And in England, it's got its own weird history where Henry VIII, you know, asserts primacy over the church there, something that previous English kings had done a bit of before in the past, but never to the extent that Henry VIII did. And then you get all these other groups that say, well, why do we have to do things the way Henry VIII wants to do it? You know, if we're going to have freedom of conscience, if we want to, you know, reread Scripture, why don't we read it our way? And they go to war with each other. And these wars begin, and it takes quite a while before they can sort things out. You see in 1555, there's this Peace of Augsburg, what it does is it sort of sets up a status quo. But it only sets it up for the Catholics and the Lutherans. If you're not a Catholic or a Lutheran in Germany, you're not protected. This is where the Peace of Augsburg, we get the whoever is ruling the territory, their religion decides what it's going to be. So you have Lutheran territories and you have Catholic territories within the German Empire. Now, the Holy Roman Empire was, in certain respects, an elective monarchy. So you have certain people who are electors, and they're associated with, they're associated with these...
Five of them.
What's that?
There are five of them who elect.
No, I think there's more than that at the time. I don't remember all of the different ones. Yeah, well, there's a number of different princes, bishops, mm-hmm. and the goal was to keep them more or less even, right? So they could reach some sort of compromise. But it doesn't always work out like that. And eventually things start heating up more. And here's where Elizabeth's family gets really involved. So her father, Frederick V, becomes the elector of the Palatinate. And he's a Protestant. They're actually Calvinist Protestants. When Bohemia, you know, the western part of the Czech Republic now, when Bohemia revolts from the Holy Roman Empire, they end up eventually, and there's a bit of, you know, skullduggery going on with this, they eventually end up electing Frederick V to be the king. Or they give him the crown of Bohemia. Around the same time, the Dutch and the Spanish resume their wars. So there's wars breaking out all over the place. And, you know, you guys all remember, like, seeing the treaties, the alliance systems that lead up to World War I and the terrible consequences of, you know, one thing leading to another, and everybody feeling like they can't back down. That's what happened in Europe. And the 30 Years' War, it's not a world war, but for Europe, especially for Germany, it's probably more devastating than World War I in many respects. And it draws in all these different powers. Now, we'll talk a little bit about, you know, some of the other stuff, but I really want to concentrate on Elizabeth's family. So Elizabeth's father is known as the Winter King, because he, unfortunately, is only king for a short time. His side loses a major battle. He has to flee Bohemia. He flees it to Silesia first, and then he goes to the Netherlands. Why the Netherlands? Because the Netherlands are Protestant, and he's welcomed by Prince Maurice, who is his uncle. And the Palatine gets occupied by Spanish troops. Spanish troops of the empire. Not only does that happen, but the emperor gives the Palatine to bits of it to Maximilian of Bavaria, and he gives him the electoral spot. So this guy now has lost his lands. He was the head of the the Protestant Confederation, but they've been crushed. And now you get these foreign powers coming in. Although they're not really that foreign, because everybody's married to everybody else and everybody knows everybody else. You start seeing these other phases. Denmark intervenes in the 30 Years' War. Why? Because Denmark is Protestant. And they have some initial success, and then the imperial troops push up into Denmark, and eventually Denmark has to concede. Around the same time, the Poles and the Swedes have been going to war for a long time, jockeying for power. In France, you've got wars of religion between the Huguenots, who are Reformed Protestants, and the Catholics. The Catholics really get the upper hand over the Huguenots and eventually crush them. You just look down this whole line. As Elizabeth is growing up, the 30 Years' Wars are going on. And people are dying, you know. About half of the population of Germany winds up dying from one thing or another by the end of the 30 Years' Wars. The Swedes intervene in the 30 Years' War. And it starts to get really weird after that. And this is where European power politics come in. Up until that time, it's mostly Protestants versus Catholics, right? And then France comes in. Who remembers what side France came in on in the 30 Years' War from their history class? Anybody offhand?
They always back Catholic.
Well, they were Catholic by then. There was kind of a period where, like under Henri Navarre, where it looked like they might go Protestant, but they'd been firmly Catholic by then. So they should come in on the Catholic side, right? They don't. the French have actually been supporting Sweden monetarily for several years, and then they come in on the Swedish side. Again, why? Because they're rivals of the Catholic Habsburgs. And so now even the Catholics aren't on the same page. Then the Danes, who are Protestant, they come in on the imperial side. They switch sides, and it's just one big mishmash, you know. And you know, there is a point where Elizabeth's father is offered by the Swedish king, Gustav Adolphus, I will give you back the Palatinate. You can be a prince again. You just have to become my vassal. And he says, no, I'm not going to do that. And he dies, you know, not that long after that. So Elizabeth is inheriting all of this. That's just on her father's side, too. On her mother's side, she's a Stuart. And you notice that they're playing a role in England, but then, you know, they'll get executed. The Civil War takes place in England. Again, a lot of it over religion with politics mixed in. And so Elizabeth is kind of bouncing around from place to place. At first, she goes to Berlin with her grandmother. She studies there. You know, she's a great student. She learns a lot. We'll talk about that in a moment. She goes to The Hague after spending a little time in Leiden, where she finishes her school. And she's, you know, she's doing the things that she's supposed to do as a member of a royal family, as a princess, as somebody who's trying to keep themselves afloat. She's coming from a family whose fortunes are really low. But she's, you know, she's still a princess. The Polish king offers to marry her. She'd just have to convert to Catholicism. She doesn't do that. And it's in part not just because of the religious thing. It's also because they're hoping that the Swedes will save the day. And they need to stay on the good side of the Swedish monarchy. There's all these connections going on. So Elizabeth has a lot on her plate. I think this would have crushed many other people. It doesn't actually do so to her. She gets a really great education. She's also, you know, brilliant, so that helps out. Her mother had also had a really great education as well. Elizabeth gets known as the Greek because she's fluent in many languages, including Greek. She learns history, geography, mathematics. She dabbles in the fine arts as well. And she's somebody who's really devoted to the life of the mind, when she's allowed to do it. One of the things you see in her letters with Descartes as a kind of hallmark is her saying, I have to end this letter now because people are pestering me with all their, she doesn't say nonsense or anything like that, but that's what happens with her. Here's one thing that she says early on in her letters to Descartes. My life is guided by the rule, inform your intellect and follow the good it acquaints you with. And then everything else will sort of sort itself out. I did mention that she had this correspondence with Anna Maria von Schnurman. And there you've got two very brilliant women, each of whom represents a particular way of doing philosophy, which doesn't just mean studying academic philosophy, but trying to make sense out of life, out of politics, out of religion. Her way of doing it, Elizabeth's way of doing it, is very similar to Descartes. We should, you know, follow reason. We don't need a lot of old Aristotle books that we have to memorize and study. We can depart from the classics. They can be useful as starting points for us, but we don't really need to preoccupy ourselves with that. We have enough in front of us. We can rely on good common sense, on observation, on, you know, a developing set of sciences and sort of reconstruct the world on that basis. Anna von Schnurman is more along the older lines. She is a scholastic, and her professor, her mentor, has got this bitter rivalry with Descartes. Descartes by now lives in the Netherlands, in part because although Descartes is a Catholic, he actually likes spending time with Protestants better, because they, you know, especially the Dutch Protestants, because they get less worked up about things, and they leave him alone to do what he wants to do. There's some rivalry going on there. The ways in which they conceive of how to do philosophy and how to do the sciences are at odds with each other. And over time, this ends their friendship. This ends the friendship between Elizabeth and Anna. Descartes also is going to have a significant influence on the development of salons, which are primarily, you know, established and run by women. They're intellectual places of engagement. In part because Descartes' method doesn't require an extensive training or having a huge library. You don't have to learn Latin or other languages. When he writes his discourse on metaphysics, he does so in French. And this is a kind of revolutionary thing to do, to not, instead of writing it in Latin, to write it in French. And why does he do that? He says that he does that so that women and ordinary men can read it and study it. Because he doesn't assume that everybody has been schooled in Latin. So this is a good intro to talking about Descartes and his influence on her. But before that, any questions? This is a good place to take a pause, too. Any questions or other comments or confusions?
It is true that she was a Jansenist, right?
That Elizabeth was?
Yes.
No, she was a Calvinist.
I see.
To be a Jansenist, she would have had to have been Catholic.
Yeah.
She did have connections with some Jansenists. So for those who don't know this term, this is a little bit of a distortion, but you could think of Jansenism as kind of a Protestant, what would you call it, way of thinking within the Catholic Church, maybe. It's very difficult to say it in a few lines. It's interesting. There were quite a few people who were kind of hard party liners. They wouldn't talk with anybody who wasn't of their particular religious denomination. Elizabeth and Rene Descartes are at the opposite end of that. They'll talk with just about anybody so long as that person isn't going to give them a hard time. There were many people who were quite willing to give you a hard time. So.
Can I ask a question about chronology? Here you have in 1632, Gustavus Adolphus proposes putting Frederick.
Yeah.
But 1641, brother Gustavus Adolphus dies. Is it the same person?
No.
Oh.
That's the Gustavus Adolphus who's named after Gustavus Adolphus.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, that would be quite extraordinary if her brother was proposing to her father to make him their vassal.
There's a backstory here.
Yeah, well, that'd be quite fun, wouldn't
Can
it?
Can I ask you a question about these Palatinates?
Yeah.
Were they like a certain type of people? What made them a group, and why are they so far apart?
Well, it's not associated with an ethnicity. It's just one of the German states.
Okay.
And you know, there's actually. I mean, there would have been peasants who had grown up there, would never get out of those areas. It was just as there were in every other place, right? But they weren't the people. It's interesting. So the Europe of that time, the nobility, and this holds for the Middle Ages too, tended to be quite cosmopolitan by comparison to the people that they're ruling over. Because they're married to each other. Some of them are out-of-towners anyway, just they've been brought in by marriage. There was a lot of setting people up with places. Wars provided good pretext for doling out spoils, So you might have somebody ruling over you who is not even connected with you ethnically at all, I hadn't thought about that for a while, but that is quite true. So, let's talk about Descartes. I'm not going to assume that anybody's read him recently, and I'll probably give you a couple thumbnail ideas about him. But everybody knows he's very important, right? So we don't have to stress that. He's viewed as one of the fathers of modern philosophy. Some people think of him as the only father of modern philosophy. I would say there's other people who kind of deserve the title too, like Thomas Hobbes in political philosophy, or maybe Machiavelli or Bacon, but he's really quite important. And Descartes is, he's a guy who, he could pretend to be humble, and, when he's writing prefaces to things, you know, especially when he has to be political and sort of cover his rear, as we say. But he really thought that he was going to change the whole of philosophy. And with philosophy, he would change society as a whole, too. And Thomas Hobbes also says things like this. He's not the only person with these aspirations. The idea was that you'd wipe away all the old stuff and rebuild on solid foundations. Descartes has this nice little visual metaphor that I think would be helpful here, and it's of a tree. And the roots of the tree are metaphysics, the fundamental study of what is, what reality is, what is it divided into, what are the fundamental modes of substance, and how are they connected. And then physics would come out of that as the trunk. And then it had three branches, and lots of leaves, of course. He didn't get down to naming the leaves. But the branches are the three M's. Mechanics, what we would nowadays call technology. Morals, he thought that you could, if you really started from the start, you could actually develop a kind of ethical code that everybody could get on board with. Now the third one is medicine. Descartes actually studied medicine. And he thought that if we could get the philosophy right, it would lead into medicine, and that would eliminate a lot of the problems that we have. Descartes is writing at a time when people are at each other's throats over all sorts of things that he considers to be prejudices based on insufficient grounds. And they're willing to kill each other over this, and they have been for a while. Descartes actually goes along in one of the armies. One of the ironies of this is that I mentioned that guy Maximilian of Bavaria as somebody who kind of despoiled the Palatinate prince. Well, Descartes was in his army, and Descartes was actually at the battle that was decisive, that destroyed the chances for the Protestant League at the time. He didn't do much of anything. Descartes wasn't a fighter. He was actually, nowadays I think we'd call him an engineer, but he was there. So he was actually on the wrong side as far as Elizabeth's family is concerned. But he and Elizabeth meet each other, and then the third thing I've got marked here on the map is the Netherlands, the United Provinces. They'd fairly recently thrown off the Spanish yoke. The Spanish had owned it before that, and were independent. And this was a place where you could go and live a fairly free life. There was a lot of what we nowadays call toleration, religious toleration in the Netherlands. That's where Descartes decided to live. That's where Descartes got a university position. That's where Descartes was writing all these people from and carrying out his scientific experiments. And that's where Elizabeth's family was settled. So they encounter each other. And she reads his book, The Meditations on First Philosophy. I actually brought along a prop, which I should get out and send around. This one is a nice edition that I particularly like. It's the French and Latin Descartes book, because Descartes wrote the Meditations in Latin. He didn't even translate it into French. He had somebody else do that for him. And you can see the French and then the Descartes' original Latin below it, and then there were these objections as well. They were written by pretty famous people like Pierre Gassendi. We'll send it around. Thomas Hobbes, and a few other people as well. So Elizabeth and Descartes meet, and they enjoy each other's company. They actually have a lot in common. Descartes had at least similar topics in his education to what she did. He talks about that in his discourse. And they begin a correspondence. And she writes him, and he writes her back. And this is what we have. This is the women that you should read. What we have are these letters back and forth from them. You could say that they're in some respects kindred spirits. And I wanted to talk about some of the key themes. I did give you one excerpt from one of the letters that gives you an idea about some of the things these two are talking about. But before we get to that, some of the other key themes. Descartes had introduced this notion of what we call Cartesian dualism, which is that the body and the soul are fundamentally different kinds of substances. And the soul or the mind, or if you want, the spirit, whatever you want to call it, is not physical at all. And the body is just a machine made of meat and bones and nerves and things like that. There's a third kind of substance as well, and that's God, but we don't really know much about God other than he's like super powerful and has every perfection and wouldn't deceive us and that sort of thing. But what Descartes was really interested in is figuring out how these meat machines work, right? And thinking about the human mind. Now, what's the big problem there? Once you've separated things out like this, how do you put them back together? How do we explain what we call voluntary action? Like, I think about raising my hand and I raise my hand, right? For Descartes, we could say, well, my brain did it, right? But the brain is just, you know, a more complicated meat machine. It's a bunch of neurons put together in a certain way. That's not actually you. The you that it has consciousness is not extended, it's not material, it is pure thought. So how the hell does that make you lift your arm when you lift your arm? That's a big question. And Descartes had some answers for that, but Elizabeth calls him on those answers. Answers that other people hadn't managed to call him on. And she says, you know, and she kind of downplays her own intelligence, unfortunately, at some points, but she does it in ways of, you know, saying, you said this, I don't really see how this works. Explain it to me. And then he explains it to her, and then she says, here's the problem with your explanation. Now, Descartes writes to her in one of the letters later on, this is in 1645, so seldom do good arguments come my way in the conversations I have in this place that hardly anyone visits, and also the books I consult, that I can't read the arguments in your letters without feeling an extraordinary joy. I find your reasoning so strong that rather than mounting a defense, I would prefer to confess defeat at their hands. There are places where Descartes says, yeah, I don't have a good answer for you. A lot of the times he does have a good answer for her, but some of the times he'll say, no, you've actually got me there. Her objections to Descartes about the mind-body connection are regarded by people in the field as one of the first really good presentations of a particular philosophical position on the relationship between consciousness and the body. Some of the other key themes, you know, they sort of work out what their relationship is going to be. Elizabeth is suffering from what she calls sadness. Nowadays, I suppose we'd probably call it depression. If you look at her life, it probably makes good sense, you know. She's got all the downsides of being a princess and none of the upsides. Because she still has people pestering her all the time about matters of state, but she has no authority and really no prospects for things getting better. But she gets drawn into schemes to try to, you know, win back their place and all of that. Descartes is going to be, she says at one point, sort of like her doctor and help her out with these things. They'll in effect do philosophical therapy. He'll help her figure out how she ought to think about matters, how to be happier, how to live with all the duties that she has, how to develop her capacities more fully. He agrees to that. She insists that he adopt something like the Hippocratic Oath. This is where the, you know, like publishing her letters comes in. If he had fulfilled that, he probably wouldn't have published them, because she'd insisted on that. They, you know, it's very clear that they're good friends with each other. When she's leaving the Netherlands, she asks him to visit her, and says, you know, I'm going to Berlin. I really want to see you before I go. But if not, you know, at least we'll have our letters back and forth. They discuss Seneca's On the Happy Life, and this is part of what this is drawn from. They say, we need a reading selection to work with, so we'll read Seneca. Seneca is a Stoic philosopher that was quite popular to read at that time. Descartes is somewhat influenced by those sorts of things. Now notice, when you read this, she has a set of objections to what Descartes has been presenting. And these are not, you know, little quibbles. These are some pretty big questions. She says, here's the difficulties I hope will be resolved by your explanations. Each one of these turns into a further discussion between them. Knowledge of God's existence and attributes can console us in the miseries that come to us from the ordinary course of nature and the order he's established. She gives some examples, and then she says, but it can't console us for the miseries other people inflict on us. It seems to us that the will of those people is entirely free, so why are they doing it? Now, this is a very practical question, since she's living in a period where people are routinely inflicting horrible things upon each other, and they have upon her family and on people that she knows. Here's the second issue. Knowing that the soul is immortal and much nobler than the body can make us not merely regard death as negligible, but outright seek death. This is a common question that comes up. Hey, if heaven is so good and the soul is so much better, why don't we just kill ourselves right now? What's your answer to this, Descartes? She's posing. The third one. As for the great extent of the universe, which you've shown in your book, The Principles, knowledge of that serves to detach our affections from everything we see in the universe, but it also separates our idea of God from our idea of particular providence, the providence that's the foundation of theology. So she's saying, hey, there's an implication to what you're teaching here. How does this work? Here's another one. The thought that we are part of a whole and that interests of the whole are what we should aim to secure is surely the source of all generous actions. But I find many difficulties in the conditions that you prescribe for such actions. When someone tries to measure the evils he brings on himself for the sake of the public against the good that will come to the public, how can the evil not seem greater to him just because he has a clearer idea? What measure will we have for comparing things that aren't known to us equally well, such as our own merit, that of the people with whom we live? A naturally arrogant person will always tip the balance in his favor, and a modest one will value him less than he's worth. This is a question about how should we live our life, not just as ourselves, but in relation to other people, in conditions of what we call imperfect knowledge. How do we figure out, you know, we can think about this in terms of our workplaces or our political communities that we live in, or the institutions that we participate in, or families. How do we make sure each person gets their fair share? And we're not taken advantage of, or we're not taking advantage of other people. This is a fundamental moral issue. Here's another great one. To profit from the particular truths of which you speak, we have to know exactly all the passions we feel and the prejudices we have, most of which are imperceptible. This is the issue that we talk about today, is cognitive bias being worked out here in their correspondence. Of course, they're not the only people doing this, I don't want to say, but this is the stuff that these people are talking about. And then finally, in observing the customs of the countries where we are, we sometimes come across very unreasonable ones that we have to follow in order to avoid even worse consequences. So what do you have to say about that, Descartes? And then she gives an example. Since I've stayed here in Ryswick, I've experienced a very trying illustration. I was hoping to have more time to study, and I actually have less leisure because of the pastimes of people who don't know what to do with themselves. It's very unfair of them to deprive me of real goods so that I can give them imaginary ones, but if I'm not to make enemies here, I have to abide by the preposterous laws of civility that are established here. Now notice how she frames this in very concrete terms. Since I wrote that, I have been interrupted 7 times by these annoying visits. How do you deal with other people's BS? You know, do you tell them you're being unreasonable with me? Do you, you know, what should I do, Descartes? And they hash this out over a number of different letters. But I just wanted to give you sort of a taste of the sort of things that these two are discussing. Another book that they consider is Machiavelli's The Prince. And she has some very definite ideas about where Machiavelli is right and where Machiavelli is wrong. She says he's great for explaining how to, you know, restore stability, but this is a terrible plan for, you know, once you've actually got stability, how to rule, you know. He's wrong in this maxim, he's wrong in this maxim. So she's a great analytic mind. They write back and forth for quite some time. Another thing that happens, I mentioned that she played some role in Descartes' death, and so we should talk about that. Descartes is invited to Sweden by Queen Christina, who is at that time governing arguably one of the strongest and most prosperous nations after the 30 Years' War. I mean, France, I would say, was, you know, equally powerful. Thanks. But Sweden is in a great location. The only bad part about it is that it's pretty cold. But they did pretty well in these wars that they're having. And Queen Christina is also somebody who is a great intellectual. She wants Descartes to come and become her tutor. They don't actually get along, in part because he doesn't really like it there. She wants him to tutor him. She wants him to tutor her first thing in the morning. And he's not... this is actually kind of an interesting little thing about Descartes. When he was a student, he worked out a scheme that would allow him to sleep in until about noon, or to remain in bed. This is a total digression, but it kind of gives you a little bit of backstory. So Descartes was a really smart guy, right? And they sent him to this Jesuit school, and he's way smarter than the other students. In mathematics, he's just knocking everything out of the park, so to speak. And they work out a deal. He doesn't like to get up in the morning. So he doesn't actually like to get out of bed. And so they work out a deal where he gets to stay in bed longer, but he has to solve mathematical problems. And if he solves mathematical problems, he gets to sleep in. It's sort of, you do this, I think, with people who are high achievers sometimes. So you can tell that getting up in the, essentially middle of the night and going to tutor the queen in this cold, drafty palace is not Descartes' thing. He also doesn't appreciate the fact that she loves, ancient literature. He's not into that sort of thing. She doesn't like his philosophy that much. They only meet for a few sessions. And he actually gets pneumonia and dies while he's up there.
Yeah. He was so young.
Yeah, he was still in his 50s, if I remember right. And, it was easy to die back then of things like pneumonia. He winds up getting buried in an orphan's cemetery because he's a Catholic in a Protestant country. Now, what's he doing up there in the first place? Christina invited him, but he also agreed to go up there to try to talk to Queen Christina about restoring Elizabeth's family to the Palatinate. He was on a mission. He wasn't just doing one thing. That's not the main thing. He's also going up there because this is a great honor and all that. But these two are connected with each other in very important ways. Descartes had a lot of other correspondence, but none of them, I would say, quite as close as Elizabeth. The other thing that I will mention, too, about Elizabeth, she gets Descartes to write his last book. He writes a book called The Passions of the Soul. And he writes this book in part because she's asking him about what we nowadays call emotions. How do the emotions work? How do they fit in with the body? Why do they affect us the way that they do? How can we define them? These days we teach about like emotional intelligence, and it's important to be able to recognize our emotions when they're happening. There's a lot of discussion of this in both ancient and in modern, early modern philosophy. Not so much in later modern philosophy. And Descartes writes a book that's a classic in this. Why does he write it? Because she says, I'm not really sure I understand what your doctrine is on these things. I would like you to present it more fully. So she spurs him to write a great work, both in philosophy and in the what we nowadays call the psychology of emotion. The other thing that I will mention from their correspondence that is probably worth hitting on, there's an interesting question that comes up, and it's one I think that we existentially pose for ourselves in a lot of cases, but we might not frame it exactly the same way. So here's how you could frame it in our time. if there's things that you would be upset about, is it better for you to not know about those things and perhaps even believe things that are false because it'll produce a good emotional affect for you? Or are you better off knowing the truth, even if the truth might make you feel less happy? This is an issue that gets posed very concretely in psychological literature. You know, if you think about the whole positive psychology movement, there's a clear answer there. Other movements take a different position. Existential psychology would say, go for truth, don't worry about how you feel about it. Cognitive behavior therapy would say, well, the truth, feeling good about it, they're eventually going to mesh up with each other sooner or later. But there are a lot of people who think, yeah, better to be deceived. So Descartes' answer to this is, there really is something to that, having positive emotions and feeling good, but actually being deceived. But in the end, truth is still better. And she agrees with him. And these are people who, Descartes is not experiencing anything like the heartache that she is. She's really had a difficult life, I would say. Would it be better for her to distract herself from this life of a princess? Or is it better to face reality straight on? These are really live questions, and I think that we can relate to this when we read these in her works. So that's sort of the chapter with Descartes. I have a little bit of other things to say, but this would be a good place to take a little break. Any questions or comments about this quite interesting relationship between these two great thinkers? Yeah.
He is quite cordial with Elizabeth in the letters. And in many other cases, he's not cordial at all. When he has this discussion with Hobbes and some of the other people.
Yeah.
And actually, I've always thought, well, he was pleasant to the people he liked, but very unpleasant to the ones that he didn't.
Yeah, you know that old phrase about suffering fools gladly. If Descartes thought you were a fool, or even off base on something, he'd let you have it. Gassendi, the letter to Gassendi, the response to objections. The things that you say just, they're not even worth engaging with. And he's saying this to somebody who's, a philosopher of at least his stature at the time. You're right. I think that they really were kindred spirits. He greatly appreciated her. She greatly appreciated him. She writes with a little bit of, what would we call it? I'm not that smart, clearly underplaying herself, self-deprecation that she didn't need to have. But they also have kind of a weird set of imbalances. She's a princess, he's a commoner, right? He's older, she's younger. He's a man at a time when women are essentially, many of them are seeing them as just not capable, full of rationality. She's a woman. Descartes never had those prejudices about women. But she does in some respects. She talks about her own body as not being, as being more something that weighs on her mind because of her gender than his is. They really did like each other. I think, actually, if they were closer in age and she had not been caught in this whole web of, being a princess, there could be a possibility that they would have, married or something.
Did she have anything to say, I guess, when she heard that Descartes had died?
I don't know about that. There's big gaps, unfortunately. Yeah. I imagine she must have seen it as a great loss. Maybe if he would have dressed up better, he wouldn't have. I don't really know. It's a bit unfortunate. Well, so she has a life after Descartes, and her life after Descartes is quite interesting. Part of it involves her becoming an abbess. She takes religious vows. We normally think about nuns and convents as being a Catholic thing. But for the early part of the Protestant Reformation, there were actually Protestant convents. They just, you know, were run in a different way. And so this convent that she belonged to had been around for quite some time. It had a long establishment. But it was also converted fairly quickly. And she takes religious vows there and then stays there. And about, some years go on, she sort of rises through the ranks and then is elected the abbess. While she's the abbess, she's responsible not just for the convent, but for the surrounding area. So some people talk about her being the princess abbess. There's about 7,000 people in the area that she's in some way responsible for. And while she's there, the convent is officially a Lutheran convent. She's actually Reformed, or Calvinist, and she welcomes in people who otherwise would be getting persecuted in other places. The Quakers are one of those groups, but there's a Catholic Jesuit turned Protestant. There's a whole movement associated with them called the Labadists, after Jean de Labadie. They actually outwear their welcome. She eventually they get into some problems with the townspeople, and she has to send them on their way. But they're there for about 2 years, and she does welcome the Quakers. I mean, we wouldn't think about somebody like William Penn, who we associated with, you know, our country, as having done a lot of stuff in Europe. But they traveled around, you know. And she gets visited by Leibniz towards the end of her life, and then she finally dies in 1680. Her family continues on, and like I mentioned, her sister Sophie is going to be in Hanover, and they're actually going to support Leibniz as Leibniz's patron. So her family is going to continue this interesting relationship with philosophers. It's unfortunate, you know, that we don't have much more of her work, because what we do have seems to be pretty brilliant. You kind of wish that she had more time on her hands and less people bugging her about random stuff because she was a princess. Even, you know, with some very adverse life circumstances and emotional issues, she seems to have done quite well. The last thing that I wanted to say was, if you wanted to read her, there you can actually find the correspondence online. You don't need to pay for it. You can, of course, buy it if you want, but you can find it online in a PDF quite easily just by Googling Descartes Princess Elisabeth correspondence PDF. Now, if you did want to read it, I think it would probably be to your benefit to look at three works. Well, actually four works. Two would be by Descartes. One would be to, you know, take a gander at the Meditations again. You don't need to read the objections and replies, I think, but it's good to, you know, from the Meditations you get a basic understanding of what Descartes' philosophy is about. You could also read the Discourse, where he talks about his own childhood and education, and you get some of the same arguments, but not quite as fully developed. The other book that could be good to read would be Descartes' Passion of the Soul, because that's the book that she spurred him to write. But you wouldn't necessarily need to read it in order to read her correspondence, because it's coming, in some respects, after that. The other two books that could be good to take a look at, one of them would be, of course, Machiavelli's The Prince, since they discussed that book. So if you're, you know, that's one that we've often read, you know, on high school book lists or things like that, or sometime in college. But it's worth going back and taking a look at Machiavelli. He was quite popular to read and to criticize in the 1600s and the 1700s. It was kind of a cottage industry, right? And then Seneca's On the Happy Life, De Vita Beata. That's the book that they're talking about. And that could be good to look at. They both criticize Seneca pretty strongly. They think that he's off base on quite a few things, but at least then you've got the reference points and you can see when they're referring to it, what they're talking about. But you notice that's not an awful lot required in order to get much out of the letters. I think they could also be read just for their own sake, to look at the sentimentality and the relationship between these two people, but you'll get more out of it if you know all the context, I think. That's all I have. If you have any questions or comments, I'm happy to take a stab at them. Yeah.
I'm kind of curious as to how these letters accumulated.
Oh.
When Descartes would write a letter, would he keep a copy of it, or would he have to rely on the recipient to keep it, and vice versa with Elizabeth?
That's an interesting issue. A lot of people would, they would, so there's letters coming to them, right? They would keep those letters, but then when they would write a letter that's outgoing, they would often keep, it's not a duplicate, because there's no way of duplicating it. They'd copy the letter, and they would keep that in there. And this goes back a long ways. Somebody else who I do a good bit of research on is Anselm of Canterbury. So now we're talking about somebody in the 12th century. Anselm preserved his letter collection from when he was a prior, and then an abbot, and then Archbishop of Canterbury, and deliberately not only kept the things, but made sure that they got published, that they were kept because they were a resource. So this notion of keeping letters goes way back, and if you think about what it was like back then. If you really cared about somebody, mortality was much more frequent. These might be the only things that you get to keep. It's interesting. I have when my mother died, we found among her stuff my dad's love letters to her, like a whole big bag. She'd put them in a brown paper bag, and they all had the dates on them and stuff like that. And, it was an interesting story that they told, At one point, he, gave her an ultimatum, and if she, she was maybe dating somebody else at the time, and, we wouldn't have known about any of these sorts of things. We don't have her letters. So a lot of context is missing. And my dad wasn't the sort to say, in your letter of such and such, you said this. Descartes, actually, and Elizabeth do quote each other's letters. Which helps for authenticating things too. It was quite common to keep duplicates. But you think about the work that was involved with that, or the security issues. Do you farm that out to your valet, and now your valet knows all your intimate things that are going on, or your secretary or somebody like that? Yeah.
Wasn't that something like Jefferson devised this machine where it would actually?
You could write more than one thing at a time. Yeah, yeah. I suppose that would be very useful, wouldn't it? It's sort of like
you wrote the same thing. If you were writing here and he'd put it over here.
Yeah, it's sort of like accomplishing what was that dark thing that we used to carbon copy
paper,
right?
Yeah.
We used to do those. Yeah, that would be doing the same thing.
What about Paul? Did he keep copies of his epistles?
Oh, who knows? I don't know. He was a roving guy, so I don't know. Yeah, that's a fascinating question. Well, they went out to the churches, and they got circulated around, because if it was a really good, this is not just Paul, but in antiquity, if somebody wrote a really great letter, and they were okay with you sharing it, it might circulate all over the place. A lot of Seneca's works are actually letters.
They'll be copied by someone else.
Yeah.
Who may or may not have done a real good job.
That's a problem in manuscript traditions. It's fortunate by the time that we've got the Meditations, we've got printing presses. And they're prone to errors sometimes. A stray letter creeps in or something like that. But you don't get as many distortions in texts as you do in ancient manuscripts.
Is there a book you would recommend about her?
Um, I don't know of a good biography on her, unfortunately. There is actually a good book out there specifically about women philosophers, and I don't remember the title. It might just be Women Philosophers of the Early Modern Period. And it's got a chapter on her that's good. And what's nice about that is that there's chapters on other women philosophers as well. But I don't know of a full book-length study. There is a... you can buy a copy of The Correspondence that does have a long, introduction, which is useful as well. But, yeah... She's a fascinating figure, you know. Again, somebody who, boy, you know, if she had been in a different family, she had the time to write, who knows what she could have accomplished.
It's like those very early poetesses, you know.
Oh.
They were great minds.
Yeah. There we've got the problem, too, if we don't know how much has been preserved.
Yeah.
You know?
But then if she had been...
Helena von Bingen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and Eloise, too, who we're going to look at. You know?
God.
I mean, imagine if Eloise had kept everything that she had written while she was an abbess about the day-to-day... you know, things that they were doing. It would be very illuminating, but we don't have it. Instead, we have her letters with Abelard, which are, her letters are much more interesting than Abelard's are. He's kind of a sourpuss by that time. So, what were you going to say?
Well, you said if she had more time and so forth, or she hadn't been a prince, but then she wouldn't have had the education and other things that may have enabled her to accomplish what she did.
Well, Descartes had a similar education. He wasn't from the nobility. If she was poor.
She was a woman, so she was a girl.
That's true, yeah. There was actually sort of a debate at the time in two ways. One was, should noble women get a full education or not? Her mother, Elizabeth Stuart, wasn't taught certain subjects because it was felt that a noble woman shouldn't dabble too much in those sorts of things. Didn't happen with her daughter Elizabeth. Maybe in part because Elizabeth Stuart was like, this is nonsense. You know, we're not doing this sort of thing. But her correspondent Anna actually wrote a piece. She wrote a thing that's, where is this? It's just called Dissertatio. And its main argument is that the study of letters is fitting for a Christian woman. Because there was a lot of debate. Should Christian women be studying, full scope of education? Or is that going to make them too uppity? Is it going to keep them from being good wives and mothers and all this sort of thing? Anna argued, no, the more education, the better. Sort of the line that you see later on with people like Mary Wollstonecraft, having to make a similar argument. That would be, about close to 200 years later. I mean, it still sometimes has to be made today, unfortunately.
Know that Elizabeth I was very educated, and so was Mary, the queen.
Oh, yeah.
They were very educated women.
Yeah.
I don't know if they wrote a lot, but they all know languages. And
yeah. Well, in order to be well-educated, linguistic study was one of those things that you needed, because so much was... I mean, Latin wasn't being spoken, but... anybody who is anybody was writing their things in Latin rather than... You can write in the vernacular. So Descartes writing in French really is a revolutionary thing. He's not trying to be snooty about it or anything like that. He's offering it to other people. Another little interesting thing, too, the Meditations, when they are translated, he sends a copy of the French one to her and with a dedication. When his Principles of Philosophy are translated into French, there's a dedication to Elizabeth from Descartes. So he clearly wanted people to know that she, you know, she mattered to him as an intellectual interlocutor, I would say.
Do we know what sort of philosophy she was taught?
Oh, in her early classes?
Yeah.
Well, it probably would have been fairly run-of-the-mill scholastic Aristotelianism. And you know, so there's the Aristotle of the time. You could almost think of it as sort of like a kind of fundamentalism of Aristotle's works, what I mean by fundamentalism is proof texting, where you say, you know, when you go to the Bible and you say, just got to find the right passage, and this will solve everything, and so you memorize a lot of passages and you trot them out. People were doing that with Aristotle's works. They're like, well, Aristotle knows everything that needs to be known, so just learn this and run into a problem, get the right passage. And that's so foreign to Aristotle's own approach. You know, Aristotle was a philosopher who deliberately works off of other people and says, we need to, you know, consider the whole spectrum of possibilities and weigh things back and forth. But he wasn't being treated like that at all in the schools. And I suspect that's probably what she was getting, you know. I mean, she knew about Descartes by reputation before she actually got to read the Meditations, in part because Descartes' new way of doing things was gaining notoriety. You know, he actually gets kicked out of a university at one point, and his works are condemned. He gets it from all ends. Yeah. Any other questions or comments or?
No, we just want to go home and read now.
Okay, good, good. Well, that's
get next door and get the books.
That's the goal. Mm-hmm. Is to draw attention to these great living thinkers. Well, thanks very much for your questions
and
your time.
Thank you very much.
And you're welcome. Yeah.